Depending on the way that we are growing that polymer out from the surface, we can create regions with nanoscale control of the blocks that are growing from the surface. So you can create, in this case, complex interfaces with different kind of functional features, chemical features, just by choosing the monomer units that you are polymerizing on the substrate. This is just a QCM trace, the trace of the post-basic microbalance. It's describing the polymer growth. The thing is that in this case, you can grow polymer films, polymer brushes, which are nearly 100 nanometers in a couple of hours. So in 2 or 3 hours, you can grow the polymer out of the surface, and you can have a fairly smooth surface, polymer surface, which is nearly 100 nanometers. This is a case of a sulfonate brush, a brush with sulfonate molecules, which is the roughness is 1.45 nanometers, and the thickness of the film is about 200 nanometers. For a 200 nanometer film, polymer film, having this kind of roughness is not very high. People who are familiar with polymer film films, you know that this kind of roughness is not very high. So this is providing a different alternative to create polymer film films which are fairly anchored to the surface with a, you know, a nice control over the thickness and the roughness. The good thing about brushes is that they are fairly anchored. So whatever we do there, we need to do, you know, we need to perform any harsh treatment to remove it. But if we just play around with simple chemistry, soft chemistry, nothing will happen. So the thing is that depending on the kind of chemistry or the kind of monomer units that you grow on the surface, you can play around, for example, with very interesting brushes, iron pair brushes, just create iron pairs, which in among the monomer unit, iron pairs and ions which are in an electron solution, you create iron pairs, and the nature of the iron pair is determining the behavior, the hydrophobic or hydrophilic behavior of the surface. So just by growing exactly the same brush, this is a brush with cationic groups, you can exchange the cation using very simple aqueous chemistry. Just put a substrate in a beaker with a aqueous solution of the anions, and you observe you can tailor the potability, the contact angle of that surface, the same surface but with different cation, in a range which is in between 19 and 79 degrees. The thing is that you can enhance these things if you are using, for example, anions which are peripherally native, and this anion which is a TFSI, or you can use anions which are highly solvated, that polyphosphate. So in that case, you can prepare exactly the same surface, the same polymer brush, same polyethylene brush, and by exchanging the cation ions, you can change the potability in a drastic way from a very hydrophilic surface to a very hydrophobic surface in a very simple manner. Just dip in water and exchanging the cation ion, and the cation ion will determine the characteristic of that surface, of that polymer brush. So the polymer brush should be like some kind of super platform for doing some kind of chemistry on the surface. In a similar way, you can create ion pairs with redox probes, with ions which are able to oxidize and reduce in a very reasonable manner. So then you can confer electroactive properties to that surface in a very simple manner. Just keep it there 5 minutes, 10 minutes in a diluted solution of cyanide, for example, which is an anion which is electroactive, and then just put it in an electrochemical cell, you scan the potential, you will observe the reversible potential, the reversible response of the electroactive cancer ions inside the film. So the thing that we are anchoring these ions inside the film is not precluding the thing that these ions are exchanging electrons with the surface, because here we have a gold electrode, this is a gold standard. So the thing is that we are able to transfer electrons in and out of the brush in a very simple manner. The interesting thing is here, this speed potential for this metallogram is indicating that the response is very, very good. If you're hindering the electron transfer, you observe some kind of shift in the peak potentials. The absence of this peak shift is indicating that the electron transfer is highly reversible, which indicates that the polymer brush is not hindering the electron transfer of the redox probe inside it. Of course, we can use also microcontact printing, but in a different way, as I mentioned before, with the LBL assembly. In the LBL assembly, we created a multilayer assembly on the stand. Here, what we use is just NIC, which is a title, with this initiator group that I mentioned before, and we stamp the initiator on the surface. And then we just use that stamped surface. This surface with this pattern, we just put in the polymerization solution, and we just draw this polymer brush in this region, these pattern regions on the surface, in a very simple manner. So you can create, also you can tailor the chemistry in domains on the surface in a very simple manner, using very simple protocols. For those who are not familiar with microcontact printing, this technique right now is quite available. You can create your own stamps, and in the case of Philips, they are using this strategy for creating patterns on surfaces, and they just creating very big stamps for stamping surfaces. In our case, the stamps that we use in the lab, they are nearly 1 square centimeter, something like that, 1.5 square centimeters, so it's much smaller than this large scale stamp. The thing that we're dealing with for electrolytes, for example, is that depending on the ionic strength of the environment, the conformational state of the poly electrolyte can be observed, can be modified. So depending on the ionic strength, we can actuate that surface, and you can promote the swelling of the film or the collapse of the film just by changing the ionic strength. And we can also, for example, as I mentioned before, you can do some chemistry in the air, you can anchor precautions that they are, for example, precautions for nanoparticles, then you can do some chemistry, reducing this precaution and grow nanoparticles inside the film in a very simple manner, and then you observe that these nanoparticles are mostly occluded within the film. This is the experimental activity data, in which you observe that there's a high contrast nearly at the center of this film, which is changing energy and thickness. Then you can remove the nanoparticles, and these are the nanoparticles which are cut by the polyelectrolyte that was stabilizing the nanoparticle inside the film. And this thing is also that you can swell the brush and collapse the brush with the nanoparticles in there in a very simple manner. So doing chemistry inside the brush isn't a big problem. You can use exactly the same thing using size selection and deposition to grow or to do some chemistry in localized domains on the surface, just by using the combination of soft lithography with this polymerization technique. When dealing with polymer brushes, what we observe is that in many cases, the interactions that are within the system are highly dependent on the nature of the monomer units. In the case of sugar-ion molecules, what we observe, which is observed, is that at a certain regime in thickness, you have the substrate, which is hydrophilic, and suddenly you see some kind of transition in cultures with using the term transition. But the thing is that you observe that we've been increasing the thickness about 60 nanometers, 80 nanometers. The brush is not hydrophilic anymore. The surface is becoming more and more hydrophobic. And the reason for that is that these polymer chains, they have a behavior which is highly dependent on the molecular weight of these polymers. So upon increasing the molecular weight, what we have is a self-association of these chains, which is called by someone in the States, called supercollapse state, in which these chains, they prefer to change from the solvated state in the supercollapse state, which is hydrophobic. So the interesting thing with this system is that now we have a system, we know that in many cases brushes, the properties of the surface is dependent on the thickness of the polymer brush. So depending on the thickness, we can have a surface which is hydrophilic, but we can have a surface which is hydrophobic. This is an important thing because these kind of moieties, sweet-running brushes in the solvective state, they are commonly used as anti-fouling surfaces in many biomedical devices or biocompatible surfaces. The thing is that we need to be very careful when we are using these kind of polymers, because if we are switching from this part to this part, which is hydrophobic, the hydrophobic surface will stick, process will stick to this hydrophobic surface very easily. So we need to know that these systems, the properties, are highly dependent on the thickness, the size of the system. This is just another example that, you know, we have this transition, that this transition is happening exactly nearly at 80 and 100 nanometers in thickness. We can use different kind of chemistry, which is photochemistry. We can use light as a stimulus for transforming the chemical molecules, the monomer units that we have in the brush. In a very controlled manner, we can use these monomer units, which are photolabile, and we can shine light to lubricate them and to remove this group and to create this group, which are carboxylate. This group, depending on the pH, they can become anionic. This is hydrophobic, this is hydrophilic. So we can grow the brush, a whole polymer, with these monomer units. We can use a mask, shine light, remove the mask, and we create a polymer layer. We have a polymer layer with hydrophilic domains and hydrophobic domains. This is a condensation image. We just create a humid environment close to the surface, and what we have is an incubation of drops. These are water drops in the pattern region, and you observe that these drops are ordered because they were initiated in these hydrophilic domains. Here you have these drops which are not uniform in size and they are randomly oriented, and the reason is that, of course, the humidity condensed in the hydrophilic part, but they are not ordered. You have the ordered droplets on the photoplasmic surface. Of course, in the same manner as we did with LDL, it is possible to grow colloids or to modify colloids with these brushes, and you can also perform some chemistry inside the brush to create this kind of complex nanomaterials. And we have core shell architecture, and you can modify the chemistry of the shell, and you can create a shell which is responsive to any stimulus. For example, chemistry use a polymer which is called polynylon, polyisopropylacrylamide, which is highly responsive to temperature. So when you increase the temperature, this polymer increases, we have a transition in solubility. So when you observe that this shell is highly responsive to temperature, so depending on the temperature, you can modify the structure of this color. So you can use color chemistry combined with polymer brushes to create, let's say, complex nanomaterials or even more complex color. The final part of the talk, I will describe this thing, which is getting some inspiration from other materials. For example, NAFIN, which is a quite common platform for protein induction, which is a very briefly, you have very small, tiny hydrophilic channels in a quite hydrophobic matrix. These hydrophilic channels are responsible for transporting or transferring protons through the membrane. And these membranes are commonly used in fuel cells. So we thought that if we were able to grow, the thing is that these membranes, this membrane is highly dependent on the conformation, is highly dependent on the humidity. Because these hydrophilic channels are created by phase segregation. So depending on the humidity and the temperature, this phase segregation can change, and the size and the distribution of hydrophilic channels can be altered. So we thought, what about if we create a scaffold with the shape, let's say, of the channel, and we create, using polymer brushes, the hydrophilic channel? At the very beginning, these channels are very small, and they are nearly 5 nanometers. We started, you know, with the top down. So we grew this kind of membrane with silicon wafers, using a photoelectrochemical etching, which the pore size is 600 nanometers. So So don't worry about that. The thing is that we started modifying these membranes and trying to modify these pores with these crushes. Because we're using very simple chemistry and we always grow the polymer from the surface, but we need this just the diffusion of the monomer inside the pore. It's not like the case of the other lecture that we needed to infiltrate the pore electrolyte inside the pore. Here we just need to get the monomer inside the pore, and then close to the pore, I will grow the polymer. It's a very simple way. So we grew these polymers, these polymer brushes, out of the pore walls. And here are examples. Yeah? We have a membrane which is nearly 100 micrometer thickness, and the pores are 600 nanometers. So here is the pore, which is filled with brushes because they grew from out of the pore walls and they just collapse in the center. And then we measure the personal activity. So just to have a look if we are doing it right or not, we just compare these NAFIN-112, which is a typical NAFIN membrane. So we observe this very briefly that, for example, at 80 degrees and 90% humidity, we have a conductivity, proton conductivity, which is nearly 15 millisieverts per centimeter. Here, for example, on the same condition and similar temperature, we also observe here that we are pretty close to that values, nearly 14, 15 millisieverts per centimeter. So this highly membrane designed by us, just using photoelectrochemical etching and some kind of brushes, is behaving like this NAFIN-112 membrane, which is NAFIN belongs to DuPont. So this is a trademark that is protected by many patents. So this thing is very simple and it's behaving like NAFIN. So we thought, why? If we're able to design, to molecularly design this pore, the chemistry that we just is taking place inside here, we can modify the number of kind of monomers in order to improve the performance of NAFIN. The problem with NAFIN is dehydration. I mentioned that before. So the thing that we need as chemists is to use a co-monomer. You grew a monomer using this monomer unit, which is, let's say, degraded. One ethylene glycol has a strong ability for water. Actually, cosmetic is typically used for moisturizing. Yeah, for example, the skin. So just replace a small amount of the monomer units of this sulfonate for this monomer unit, which is uptaking water, and we repeated these results, the same experiments. And the same experiments are really interesting because, for example, using 117, which is also a very, very good NAFIN membrane, we observe that when we decrease the relative humidity, proton conductivity is decaying. We have a sharp decrease, two orders of magnitude. Our membrane, our prototype that I mentioned before, is really bad. But when we observe the behavior of this membrane, which we modify the polymer brush, and we added a little bit of this co-monomer, what we observe is that the proton conductivity is very good. It's not only very good, it's good and it's not depending on the relative humidity. So this system, this hybrid membrane that was designed with polymer brushes, is behaving with a high conductivity behavior all over this relative humidity range. And more important, when we increase the temperature close to 100 degrees, because the operational condition of fuel is 80 degrees, we observe that the conductivity is not changing. So the thing is that just promoting small changes in the chemical structure of the polymer brush is promoting drastic changes in the behavior of this membrane that was synthesized in the lab in a very simple way, very simple manner. So we thought about decreasing even more the size of the pores, because we wanted to explore what is really happening with small pores and with polymer brushes. And as I mentioned before, we use other systems for inspiration. In this case, we use biological pores as a source of inspiration. Biological pores are very small things. Now, the building blocks with very defined functional behavior, which is operating and controlling many transport processes in membranes. So we also took some inspiration from Benjamin Deschamps, in which he suggested more than a decade ago that flexible polymers and nanopores could be very interesting, and you will see many interesting behaviors, new behaviors. What we use is track edge membranes. You just get a polymer membrane, which is nearly 12 micrometers thickness. You just use a highly ionic radiation. The thing is that we use irradiation of you create membranes with only one pore. We use single nanopore membranes. These membranes are prepared at the GSI lab in Germany, which is providing the chance to get a membrane with a single nanopore. And we're talking about nanopore, I'm talking about that depending on the experimental conditions, you can create a membrane, which is physically 2 square centimeters, and you have in the middle, or right at the center, one pore which is in between 5 and 15 nanometers. The thing is that we use this cell to measure the transmembrane transport, and we use, as exactly as in the biological fluid, we use potassium chloride as an electrolyte, and we observe the ionic transport through this membrane. So if we modify the pore with, for example, thermoactive polymer brushes in which we can promote the collapse or the swelling of the brush, we observe that we can control the conductivity of the membrane. These are because we are changing the effective pore size depending on the conditions of the polymer brush. Here are the values of the diameter, and this is, of course, when we are changing the temperature, we are also changing the specific conductivity of the solution. So this is a correction of these values, considering that the solution, the conductivity is changing. The thing is that inside the pore, you can grow a polymer brush, which can be protonated or deprotonated. This can be polymer brush, could be pH responsive. The good thing is that inside the pore, which is nearly 12 nanometers, when you protonate and you have a brush, which per each grafting site, I can grow many monomer units, I can increase a lot the charge density of the pore walls, and I can promote drastic changes in the pore conductivity. So the thing is that by changing the pH from 2 to 10, so from full protonation to deprotonation, what we observe is that the conductivity of the pore suffers a drastic change. And the thing is that because we're dealing with a chemical equilibrium in which the pH is tuning the protonation of these polymers, which are grafted to the pore, these polymer brushes, the pH is regulating the accumulation of charges on the pore walls. So that thing is translated into this kind of plot. About pH nearly 5, now the brush is fully deprotonated. I don't have any charge inside there. But after, when I decrease more and more the pH, and I start to protonate more and more this polymer brush, I start to increase the charges inside the pore, I start to modify the number of carriers, ionic carriers inside the pore, and I start to increase the pore conductivity drastically. And you observe that this behavior is fully reversible. It's quite similar to many biological pores in which you tune the conductivity just by playing around the protonation of or deprotonation of residues in the protein. In this case, it's just a polymer brush in which we play around the protonation and deprotonation to tune the conductivity or conductance of the pore. The thing is that polymer brushes into this solid state pore, we tried to study a little bit in collaboration with guys like me, Ron Oyster, using this molecular theory, and we provided experimental data, and they used the molecular theory to try to model this pore modified in brushes. We used many experimental techniques to get some parameters to describe the system. So we gave the experimental data, all these parameters that were experimentally obtained, and we gave them to all the information to work on this system. After let's say, a couple of months, they send an email, and it's only, okay, send me this, the raw data that you publish in the paper, because want to have it on the theory going on. It is hard to believe, but the thing is that after sending the raw data, they send this plot. This is the result from the molecular theory, and these blue dots are the experimental data. This is the data that you should expect if you don't consider charge regulation inside the pond. What is charge regulation? You are creating charges in a highly confined environment in a polymer with many monomeric units. They don't want to get charged. They want to remain neutral. But you are pumping protons inside there, and suddenly you start to get them charged. And this shift here is indicating that the actual decay, the actual chemical behavior of the polymer brush is shifted, is different from the planar surface. So the polymer brush on the planar surface is behavior in a different way than on the planar pole. Another thing is that to describe the connectivity that I mentioned before, the only way to have that connectivity is that the pore should have inside it a cationic concentration, a potassium concentration of nearly 2 molar. The electrolyte concentration is potassium chloride 0.1 molar. When I modify the nanopore with a brush inside the nanopore, I have a solution which is unipolar. I have 2 molar potassium. I have just a small amount, very small amount of chloride, which is nearly 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 molar chloride ions. So that means that that pore is highly preselective and is preconcentrating cations, which are cations, and excluding the coions, which is a very interesting behavior. Then we can prepare conical nanopores. And the thing with conical nanopores is the asymmetric, or the asymmetry in the geometry of the pore, when you just create charges on this conical pore and you solve the Poisson-Nernst Planck equations of electron diffusion, what you observe is that you expect some kind of rectification behavior. It's not the same way, you don't have the same ionic current if you polarize the membrane in this way or in the other way around. So that means that this rectification is currently used in nanofluidics as to create ionic rectifiers. So the thing is that in the case of ionic rectifiers, or nanofluidic rectifiers, is a rectification efficiency. It's, I want this as big as possible and this as small as possible. I want to have something like this, but I want to have a full rectification system. The rectification is obviously highly dependent on the geometry of the pore, but it's also highly dependent on the surface density. So brushes can be very interesting in this aspect, because for each grafting site, I can grow several charge moieties, and I can tune the surface charge of the nanopore in a very simple way. And this is exactly what you observe when you create, for example, you use, for example, phosphate moieties when you have different protons, and you can tune the charges of these moieties by changing the pH. What you observe, don't worry. What you observe is that when increasing the pH, when you start to create more and more negative charges on the pore, you observe a sharp increase in the rectification. The rectification, the degree of rectification is nearly 50, between 50 and 60. For those who are not familiar with this field, when you modify the conical nanopore with simple monolayers, the typical degree of rectification is between 5 and 8. So by using polymer brushes inside the pore, you boost a lot the preselectivity of the pore and increase a lot the rectification of this nanopore, this conical nanopore. And of course, we're a chemist and we like to play around these kind of chemistries, and we can create a polymer brush with sweet drying moieties which are depending on the pH. So depending on the pH, that polymer brush can be positive or negative. So If you have a positively charged pore, I will have one kind of rectification. But if I reverse the charge, I will have the opposite rectification. So having exactly the same nanopore with exactly the same brush by changing the pH, I can have a rectification in one direction or a rectification in the other direction. So that means that getting together, blending concept of polymer chemistry, polymer brushes, with this concept, which is something related somewhat to biophysics, can be a very interesting approach to create this kind of nano devices or nano system with very, very well defined rectification properties. So finally, I'm going to skip this here. This idea of using mesoporous films. We can grow film, but in a very simple way, where we can now have channels which are nearly 8 nanometers. At the very beginning, I had a membrane with many channels, they were 600 nanometers. Then I increased the size of the pore, but I had only one pore. Now I have a film with many pores, with a high density of pores, and the size of the pores is nearly between 8 and 10 nanometers. So we can use exactly the same kind of chemistry to grow brushes out of these mesopores. And we can play around two different kinds of chemistries. The thing is that we can play around the chemistry of the typical pore wall, because when we are dealing with very big pores, the chemistry that is happening inside there is ruled by the polymer. And when we start to increase the size of the pore, now the chemistry of the pore is also saying, hello, I'm here. And that is a big issue. The thing is that we have a system with polymers which are superionic, the polymers that I described before, with an isoelectric bond which is close to 5. So, depending on the pH, above 5 or below 5, I can have a positively charged polymer and a negatively charged polymer. That is the meaning of the isoelectric bond. And then I have a pore wall with a pK2. What is it? What is the meaning of pK2? That means that, dealing with pH above 2, this pore wall is negatively charged. So in the range above pH 2, the pore wall is negatively charged. So we can grow the system, and the thing is that what you can think is that when you are dealing with parent selectivity, in many cases, I say, okay, I can create a nanopore. I create a nanopore which is positive and negative. If the nanopore is positive, it's rejecting the transport of anions. The cations and promoting the transport of anions. If the pore is negative, it's the other way around. The thing is that it's not that trivial. You're playing around with cations and anions. If the cations are getting into the air, anions stay outside and the other way around. The thing is that nature uses different mechanisms. For example, to play around what kind of ions and to keep their ions inside. For example, neurons. We have different channels that they are able to play around the transfer of cations and just to inhibit the transfer of anions. So keeping the anions silent, keeping away, and to play around the on-off state of cations. So that is not that trivial in material science, designing that kind of interfaces. And that is the case of, for example, if you observe that in the mesoporous field, which is anionic, you observe something like that. At high pH, you have that this nanopore is anionic, so you see that the transport, the diffusion is an electrochemical signal that is telling me that the cation is getting into the air. So we observe that the electrochemical signal for the cation and for the anion is very small. When I decrease the pH close to the decay, I observe that the signal for the anions is increasing, and the reason for that is that I'm just trying to remove the anionic charges from the mesopore. So that really makes sense. However, when we studied exactly the same thing with the mesoporous silica, which was modified with the sweetener and polymer brushes, what we observed is that you observe the signal corresponding to the cations. So the cations at pH 5 and 8, they are diffusing through this hybrid film. But the anions, they stay outside this polymer film. The transport is inhibited. However, when we decrease the pH close to pH 3 or 1, What you observe is that now two ions stay outside the filament. So what you observe is that the anions are always excluded from the filament in order to tune and to play around the transport of the cation. So the anions are fully conservative, they stay away, and you play around the cations. And the reason for that, for keeping the anions silent and to play around the cations in a similar way that these biological pores, is exactly using the chemistry of the support scaffold and the polymer. Why? The reason is very simple. At pH about 5, as we mentioned before, I have ionic charges in the polymer, and I have ionic charges in the mesophore wall. Mesophores are very small, I mentioned 8 nanometers roughly. So what we observe is that you promote the transfer of cations and you preclude the transfer of anions. However, when you decrease the pH below 5, what you have is now the polymer is positively charged. You have a cation here, a polycation. But the pore wall is still anionic. Having a highly confined charge or a bipolar pore wall, which is cationic and anionic, is called the bipolar exclusion. It's a bipolar blind exclusion. A small pore, which is bearing positive and negative charges, are rejecting the transport of cations and anions, both of them. So this is the reason why we can create this kind of filter for ions, just by using the chemistry of the mesophore wall and the polymer brush. So this is a very simple way to play around different chemistries in highly confined environments to create interfaces with different kind of functional features. So as a summary, it's just about, I just wanted to mention that polymer brushes is a very simple tool, even if I describe many systems with different kind of monomer units. The chemistry is the chemical protocols are very simple. Anyone from outside chemistry, like physicists or engineers, they can grow brushes very easily. And you can design your own systems, you create your own systems using different kind of chemistries in confinement. That is a very interesting thing. And the thing is that you can create from nanophilic rectifiers to proton channels or to hybrid nanostructure platforms in a very simple way. Finally, I'd like to thank the funding agencies, like I can see here Argentina, CONICET, I'm a member of CONICET, the Mad Fund Society, which is also funding our group here in Argentina, the partner group, in reactions, because we have a European project. All the people that were involved in many of the experiments and the results that I described in these two previous lectures. And thank you very much for staying here when you are hungry and you want to go for lunch. Thank you very much.